Brotherhood and WMU are asked to meet at 3 o'clock. Any other announcements?
Brother Eugene, I got a Gavin Bird speaking for a trip that I put together. I'm looking at the rooms at Oak Creek Lodge in Gatlinburg, Tennessee. To make sure you've got the paper with the cell phone number on the book, so you can go ahead and put your room in your issue. Right now we've got 15 rooms, double bed rooms, put their men for those who want to go. Some will stay Monday through Sunday. Some can come up during the week. That's your option on that.
Okay.
But if you're not got that flyer, just get up with me.
Thank you, brother.
That's July 29th through August 4th.
On behalf of the student ministry, we want to thank all of you who participated Friday night. It seemed like we had a lot of people who enjoyed it, and so we just want to say thank you. We were able to raise a little over $500, wow. So we appreciate that so much. And so we still have some of our cocoa bombs left to sell. We will be set up over in the Family Life Center if you are interested. Please come by. These were a big hit Friday night. They are deliciously sweet. And it will be cold this week, so you're going to need something to warm you up. So make sure you got your milk ready. Come get your cocoa bombs. We have them over in the Family Life Center.
Thank you, sister.
All right. The electives class is starting a new book next Sunday, if you want to join us. The book is 12 Truths and a Lie. It's the answers to life's biggest questions. You might hurry on K-Love. It's one of their K-Love sponsored books that just came out. Even has a hard copy. So next week, our question will be, how can I know for sure I'll go to heaven? The class is kind of excited about chapter 5, which is, isn't the Bible's morality outdated? How about number 8, I believe in God, why do I still struggle with anxiety? Or 12, how should Christians handle political differences? So each chapter is going to cover a different question. There's some really great questions, so if you want to join us on Sunday, or maybe there's just a Sunday you want to join us that there's a question that's been on your mind. The lie is that we're often discouraged not to ask questions. That if we doubt by asking questions, then we're not a real Christian, and we might not even be a Christian. So it really goes into the whole idea, especially as young Christians, the importance of asking those questions. So this book, if you're just haven't been saved for that long, this might be a really good place to start. So join us on Sundays. We're down the hallway. I don't know where that room is, but we're down that way.
Any other?
Real quickly, the mission team that sponsored a Valentine's banquet February the 10th. The meal will be chicken Alfredo and ribeye. I think Miss Iola is working on our tickets, so as soon as those tickets are available, if you will see some of our mission team to purchase those tickets. I think the ribeye is $30 for two. I think the chicken Alfredo will be for a couple, will be $20 a couple. But if you'll see one of the mission team, if the mission team members are in here, stand up so folks can see who you are. So if they need to get a ticket, they can come and see you for a ticket. Otherwise, if you don't see them, just go to the office and get it from them.
Thank you, sister.
Secret Sisters are going to be drawing names at the worship here in the sanctuary.
Okay. Thank you. Anyone else? Thank you.
Good morning.
Morning. Morning.
Welcome to Reedy Branch. Who's glad to be here?
I am.
If you're glad to be here, stand up. A while ago, I told you about a Jewish tradition where at the beginning of the service, you look at the door and you with open arms, you say, "Welcome, Holy Spirit." So I invite you, turn around and look at the door closest to you. Hold your arms out. And say, "Welcome, Holy Spirit."
Welcome, Holy Spirit.
Into this house of worship.
Into this house of worship.
Amen. Let us sing that same spirit.
Jesus said, "It is expedient for me to go." This road we're on is a rough one, isn't it, church? But with God, all things are possible, isn't it? One day, we're going to reach glory, aren't we? And what a day that'll be. Sing with us, Glory Road.
able to remain standing, we're going to ask you to remain if you're able. We understand that sometimes standing for a long period of time can get the best of us, but if you're able, this feeling when we're standing, it feels like we're a little closer, we're more together, especially when we're coming together to pray. And this is our prayer time, and we do want to give you opportunity to offer up a prayer request. Before you do, I want to share a couple. One, Miss Terry Carter. This is John L. Carter's daughter-in-law. This is Lex Carter, his wife. She's a neighbor of ours. She has asked that we would remember her in prayer. Also, we want to remember Preacher Kent Chavis, his wife's family, his father-in-law, Mr. Les Locklear. He passed away yesterday morning or afternoon, sometime morning, afternoon, yesterday. So we do want to keep Miss Darce and her family in prayer. Also, we want to remember Brittany. We know Brittany is pregnant. We notice Clem's not here in the choir loft right now. She had to leave. Brittany passed out. Don't know what's going on, don't know anything else right now at this moment, but we do want to keep her and the family in prayer at this time. Any other prayer requests? Let's remember Miss Annette Brewer in our prayers. Miss Lynette. And Brother Robert's grandson, he was airlifted to Chapel Hill.
My mother-in-law, Regina Hunt, everyone knows her as Dinky.
Let's remember Miss Dinky.
Remember my co-worker, her name's Dana Mack. She's in the hospital. We're thinking that she had Esther, and
let's do remember Miss Dana Mack. It's good to have Brother Ronald back with us today. Weren't able to be with us. Was cooped up in the emergency room for a couple of days up in Pinehurst. We're glad he's back with us today and feeling better. Yes. Yes. Let's do remember Miss Courtney's family, her mother particularly, as they are dealing with loss. Let's do remember Miss Andre. Yeah, let's do remember Preacher Don Bullard, also Brother David Hunt. I'll share a little bit more about Preacher David at the end of the service today. Let's do remember Brother Ted, our shut-ins, Miss Kristen Carter, Miss Evelyn Jacobs, Miss Frances Brooks. We've got so many. Miss Barbara Chavis. Let's do remember Mr. Thomas Locklear. Miss Zima Dell. Miss Flowers. We have so many. We do want to remember each one of our shut-ins.
Remember my wife.
Yes. Yes, let's do remember Miss Rosa. We do want to keep her in prayer. Let's do remember Brother Brantley, Miss Linda, Brother Clinny. Let's do remember Miss Floyce in prayer as well. Yes, let's do remember Miss Annie Ruth's sister. Let's do remember Justin. He was baptized just a couple weeks ago. Remember him and his children.
Pastor, I got some ladies that are very close to me. They have experienced some deaths in their family. One's lost a sister. One lost a brother-in-law. One is Miss Kathy and Mr. Grant here. They've lost some family members. Let's pray for them.
Amen. Amen.
Her,
family, Miss Nancy Jacobs. Let's do remember them in prayer. Do remember Brother Gerald as he has some tests upcoming. And I want to thank each one of you. I do want to thank you for giving me the freedom this week to be away at Southeastern there in Wake Forest. It was that class is behind me. So we're starting more classes. Well, I do have some post work's got to be done, but I got a couple of the classes starting next week. But I do thank you for your patience and your willingness to allow me to do this with liberty. It's going to be for your benefit as much as mine, the things that we're being exposed to. It'll be for your benefit as much as mine. Any other prayer requests? Let's do be in prayer for Mr. Kelvin Locklear, Miss Rhonda's brother.
I want to thank everybody that prayed for me. I think that's the first Sunday I missed church. And if I weren't here, I was somewhere else.
Yeah.
And it's not a good feeling.
Yeah, it's good to have you back, Miss Joyce. It's good to have you back. We thank you for your prayers for Miss Joyce. Yes. Do be much in prayer for Brother Don as he is traveling this week.
Actually, I got that changed to a virtual train, so thank the Lord for that.
Thank you. Thank you.
No, you didn't tell me that.
Yeah. Yeah. Any others? If not, we're going to ask. Go ahead. We'll ask Brother Kenny as he's making his way to the roster to lead us in prayer. What?
My mom's aunt just recently passed away.
Yes. Yes. Let's do remember Miss Shirley's family as Miss Evelyn's aunt. She's the baby girl, and she has went on to be with the Lord this week. Let's do remember her family. Yes. Brother Clarence and Miss Lucille. Miss Lucille Locklear. Let's do remember them in prayer. You see what we're trying to do here. There's a lot of folks who aren't able to hear the prayer request. When it's not going through a mic, those who are watching online, and even within the building. So that's why we're trying to repeat each one so that everyone hears these requests, because your prayers matter. Amen. And these requests matter to yes. each one of us. So we do want to continue. And if you would pray here at this mic, Brother Kenny, as you lead us, we're going to ask every heart to pray. We know God is a healer. God is a burden bearer. God is concerned about us more than we're concerned about ourselves. Amen. So as we look to Him and we go to Him in prayer, let's be honest with God and let's trust Him as He leads us, guides us as He directs us. Brother Kenny.
Just one more, brother. Let's remember Brother Brantley and his wife as well.
Yes. We mentioned Brother Brantley and Miss Linda.
Let us all pray. Our most gracious and kind Heavenly Father, Lord, it's once again we're so privileged, Lord, to be in your house this day, Lord, realizing, God, that you're still on your throne this morning, and God, you're high, and God, you're lifted up, Lord. And God, as we've come into this holy place and your holy presence today, how humble we are, Lord, to be able to come to the God of heaven, the one who spoke the world into existence, God. God, what a great God you are, God. And God, we're just humbled, Lord, that you love us so much, Lord, that you'd give us an audience with you. And God, as we've come this morning, God, we just want to thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for us, Lord. God, we want to thank you, Lord, for the clothes on our back, Lord, and the food we have at home to eat, Lord, and somewhere to lay down, Lord, realizing it's all because of you, Lord. All good things come from you, Lord. And God, as we look to you this morning, God, for our help, God, for our strength, Lord, and God, for leadership, Lord. God, we're asking you now, Father, Lord, that you would lead and guide us, Lord, along this way, Lord. Realizing, God, we have a goal to see you one day, Lord. God, we want to see the risen, crucified Savior, Lord. And God, be able, Lord, to lay all our crowns at your feet, Lord. For God, you're worthy this morning, God. God, for our praise upon our lips. God, for our service. God, you're worthy of it all, Lord. Without you, Lord, God, we're nothing. And God, we just thank you, Lord, that you have taken time out, Lord, to hear us this morning. And Father, Lord, as you have heard the request, you already knew about them, Lord, before. But God, I'm so glad your word tells us that you are a great burden bearer, Lord. God, that when we don't see a way, Lord, you are a way maker, Lord. God, when we're in the dark, Lord, God, you are our light, Lord. God, you're our food, and God, you're our water. You're our confidant, Lord. God, you're our special friend. And God, we're so thankful, Lord, that God, when we can't see you working, Lord, you're working on our behalf, Lord. God, we just praise you to the highest this morning for who you are. God, we praise you for what you are, that you are our King. You're the King of kings and the Lord of lords. God, you are the beginning, and God, there is no end to you. And God, we just ask you, Lord, these requests that you would have your way, Lord, because you know best, Lord, that your will be done, Lord, because, God, you know what we need, Lord. God, we ask you, Lord, to bless us for being here this morning. We ask you, Father God, that you would have your will and your way throughout this service, Lord. Move, Lord, God, throughout the pews, Lord. Give us what we need, Lord, because you know, Lord, and only it comes from you what we need, Lord. God, we ask you, Lord, to have your way. Have liberty, Lord, in this service, Lord. God, that your people be blessed for coming this way. And God, we do ask you now, Lord, especially, God, if there's one or two or three, or more who doesn't know you as a personal Savior. God, I pray this day, Lord. God, that the Holy Spirit knocks, that they would open the door and answer, Lord. What a great day it would be, Lord, for them to give their life to you. For God, you are a soon coming King. God, you came as a lamb the first time. But God, on the second return, you'll come as the King of kings and the Lord of lords. And God, you'll be triumphant, Lord. And God, one day we'll see you come in the eastern sky and call your church home, Lord, and God will forever be. And God, we don't want to leave anyone behind, Lord. God, no one wants to see their loved ones stay behind. God, let this be today. Now, Father, we ask you now a special blessing on this worship hour, Lord. Be with the man servant as he stands to proclaim your word, Lord. God, give him what you have him to say, Lord. God, we want to hear from you this morning, God. Use your manservant, Lord, as you please. Now, Father, we ask you to bless this day. Bless what we fail to ask is my prayer. Amen.
Amen.
Amen, amen. We think about our own situations and those of others around us who are sick and hurting. We think, how can there be a way out? Let's remember that God is the way maker. No matter what we're going through, he is able. Sing with us. Worship God our Savior.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are. Yeah.
Thank you, Lord. He is able to move in ways we cannot imagine. Able to carry us through. Sing with us.
Funny you mentioned that, you said that, because last night it was all over the choir when we practiced that song. God is able, church. No matter where you're at, no matter what you say, no matter what you say he can't do, he will do, and he is going to do it. Help us sing this song, because God is able. God is up to something you may not know, but all you got to do is trust and believe he is up to something. Just pray he chooses you and uses you, because he will equip you. He gives you what you need. It's up to you to choose to obey. Let's obey him this morning. God is able.
God is able.
Just to carry
you through.
Well,
Praise today, isn't he? Yes, he is. I can't thank y'all enough for the graciousness that you've shown us, and we want to thank Brother Crafton. He is he agreed last week to speak for us today. I got home yesterday about 4 o'clock from spending 3 days in an intense class, and I just didn't have it in me to prepare. I was just mentally and physically exhausted. And so, and I knew that it would be that way because of the last two that I've been to. And with it being on a weekend, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday this time, I knew I wouldn't be able to prepare properly. Not with the work that I had to do in the first of the week to be prepared for the end of the week. So, we're glad Brother Crafton has agreed. We're going to turn him loose and let the Lord use him and let him bless us with what he's given him, Brother Crafton.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Aren't you glad God is able?
Yes.
So am I. I'm so glad we serve a God who has all power, who has all authority. He said at one time, he told his disciples, I have all authority. All authority is given to me. All. Therefore, I have the power to command you and direct you. All authority in heaven is mine at this time. We're so happy to have this opportunity today to come and share with you. And as we begin to try to seek God's will as to what we ought to do, of course, that's always needful. Before we do anything, it's needful to just go to the Lord in prayer and just listen to him and see where he takes us. But we are glad to be with you this morning. We trust you've had a good week. And may I say, you're not here by an accident.
Right.
I want you to know that.
That's right.
You're here by the divine grace of Almighty God. Were it not for his grace, you wouldn't be here. And you're here for a purpose. Didn't just come to look good and be good. We come for a purpose. If you're saved, we come to worship. Amen?
Amen.
Our business is to worship God here. We worship him through song, through prayer. Now it's time to worship through the word, I tell you that. So we come to worship.
Amen.
If you're out of fellowship with the Lord, you need to get back in fellowship.
Amen.
I know in this audience there's some out of fellowship. Don't have to tell me that. And there are those who are lost. And boy, you're the most desperate of all.
Amen.
Thank God he's allowed you to come again. That God will move in your heart and move in this place and speak to your heart that you might be saved, my friend. This might be saved. As we come today, we're going to be turning to Ephesians chapter 2. This is a familiar portion of scripture, verses 1 through 10. The emphasis will probably be a little bit different than what you've heard. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. Paul's letter to the church at Ephesus. Although this is written to the church at Ephesus, it's written to you and I, the church, this local church here at Reader Branch. May we read. It says, "And you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in times past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the earth, and that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom we also had our conversation, that is our lifestyle in times past, in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others." He says, but God. I love those contrasts. But God. Remember that. But God. But God says, he says this, but God, who is rich in mercy, and for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, and he has quickened us together with Christ. It says, by the grace are you saved, and has raised us up together, and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come, he says this, he might show or demonstrate his exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us through Jesus Christ. It says this, it says, for by grace are you saved, have been saved through faith and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast, for we are his workmanship. We are his workmanship. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God has before ordained that we should walk in them. May we pray. Blessed Father, dear God, O Father, as we come before your most holy and divine presence once again. O Father God, I just thank you for this awesome opportunity. Father, realizing, Father, I am nothing. I can do nothing, Father God, without you, unless he, the Holy Spirit, moves and speaks to me, Father. All we say is in vain, Father. But blessed God, I'm not trusting Crafton this morning. I'm not trusting anyone, Father, but you. I'm looking to you, Father, that you will use this old poor man, his poor mouthpiece, to speak forth the word, Father God, that you would have us to hear this day at Reader Branch. And blessed Father, I'll be sure to give you the praise, honor, and glory for all that is accomplished, for it's in the worthy name of Jesus, oh God, I do pray. As we come here this morning, you may be seated, as we come, that's an old song. I want to say, that's an old song we used to sing. Most of you don't remember this song. And let us know our purpose here. It says, titled, Brethren, We Have Come to Worship. How many knows that song? Anybody? Thank God that some knows it better. Let me just read the first chorus. Brethren, we have come to worship and adore the Lord our God. Will you pray with all your power while I try to preach the word? All is vain unless the Spirit of the Holy One comes down. That is so true. Unless the Spirit comes and moves this morning, all we say is in vain. It won't amount to anything. He says, brethren, pray in holy manner. We'll be showered.
Come on, brother.
Amen. All around. Amen. That's a wonderful song. Amen. It's a wonderful song with a wonderful message. This morning we're going to, God has given me the thought, living without hope. Living without hope. There are countless millions and millions of people today living with no hope at all. Nothing to look forward to. I was that way one time, and so were you. At one time, we was all without hope. All. Everyone, everywhere, living without hope. Notice how Paul begins to talk here. There are several ways you could interpret this. Paul looks at our past, our present, and our future. Everyone has a past. Most of us are ashamed of our past. Amen? I am. A lot of things I said and did, I'm ashamed of. But you know, someone has forgotten my past. Someone has wiped my past out. The day I was born again, my life began anew. Amen? The day you was born again, with a clean record. Oh, ain't that something? Yes. But Paul says this, and you has he quickened. That means made alive. And you who has quickened and made alive who were dead in trespasses and sins. Boy, that's something. Paul's talking about the church at Ephesus. He's talking about you and I. One time we were dead. You know that? We were dead. Dead to God and dead to the things of God. God took Ezekiel to a valley one time. He showed him a valley of a bunch of dry, dead bones. And God asked him, he said, can these bones live again? He's looking at dead bones. What man would ever think dead bones could live again? He said, Lord, only you know. Only you know. And Lord, if you don't do something, those dead bones would never live again. One time I was a dead bone. One time you were a dead bone. You know what? Good God did something. He did something. Today, I'm alive. Not only am I alive today, I'm alive forevermore. And the life that I now live is a new life. It is Christ who lives in me. How about you? Paul says, I have been crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet it's not I, but it's Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave his all for me on that old tree. You know what? I'm alive today. God has moved and quickened me. He's moved and quickened some of you. And there may be some dead bones in this crowd today. But if you look to God, he'll do the same thing he did for those bones in that dry valley. He'll do for you the same thing he did for me. He'll bring you alive today. He'll bring life out of death. Amen. I want you to know that. But Paul says this. He says, you were dead in trespass and sin. You know, when Paul said they were dead, they were alive physically. He means they were dead to God. You know, it's not our fault because we were dead to God. That's what we inherited from our forefather. We can thank Adam for the fact we came here dead to God. That's right. You recall when God created Adam and made a beautiful garden and gave him some instructions. He said, Adam, go in that garden. Eat of all the trees you want to, as much as you want, as often you want. But there's one tree you are prohibited to eat. That's the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. He says, when you eat of that tree, if you do, Adam, you'll die. You will die. And we know the story. Adam ate. And the day he ate, he died spiritually. He became a dead bone. He died spiritually. And all of his offspring came here dead. Dead to God, with no capacity for God, to no inclination for God. You couldn't, didn't love God, didn't do anything to please God. We were just a dead bone. He says, hey, and we were like that. We were dead. And Paul says here in chapter verse 2, said, we know, he said, we lived according and walked according to the way the world did. The prince of the power of the earth and all this who work in disobedience, says, among whom we all had our conversation or lifestyle in times past, he says this, forfeiting the lust of the flesh and all this and all that, and were by nature, the children of wrath. You know, Let's face it. At one time, we lived our life our way.
That's right.
Amen?
That's right.
We did those things that was right, we thought was right in our sight.
That's right.
We did that which felt good, looked good, made us feel good. Anything to satisfy this old sinful nature we had, we indulged in. Tell you that. It says this. We did what we wanted to do. The last verse in the book of Judges says this. There was no king in Israel at that time.
That's right.
And every man did that which was right in his eyes. Amen?
Amen.
Boy, it sounds like today, don't it?
Yeah.
It sounds like the day we live in. Boy, the Bible's up to date. It never comes out of date. We have living in a day where those who don't know God is doing anything and everything that they feel is right in their own eyes. It's a day when people dabble and live in sin. It's what we live in. And the Bible says there is pleasure in sin for a season. Amen. We'll confess. But you know what? It's just for a season. Matter of fact, we're here just for a season. This world is not our home. Hey, we're going somewhere. And God gives us the freedom to live this life any way we choose. Amen? You can live it any way you choose. But I can tell you this. If you live it in the way you choose, there's a great, great price you will pay.
That's right.
A tremendous price. A price you would never think you could ever pay. Yes. That's the way we live. And in verse 12, he says this about that life of chapter 2. He says, at that time, notice what he says. When you were in that state, you were without Christ.
Right.
Separated from Christ. Without God. Living in a world without God and without Christ. And all the promises in this Bible meant nothing to you. You couldn't claim any of them.
That's right.
None of those promises mean anything to you.
Yeah.
And it says, at that time, in verse 12, you were living with no hope.
That's right.
Imagine living with no hope. No hope. No tomorrow. If you're living without hope, it's not going to get any better.
That's right.
This is the best it's going to get. Life is downhill all the way. Downhill, downhill, downhill. But I got news for you. Someone came 2,000 years ago that we could have hope.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Somebody came that we could have hope. Now, they were living without hope, without any future, dying in sin. And back there in that third verse, they was dying under the wrath of God. Boy, we don't hear much about the wrath of God. The wrath of God for those who die as a dead bone is going to suffer the wrath of Almighty God. God tells us through John. He said, whoever believes on the Son has everlasting life. Those who do not believe do not have life, but they are living under the wrath of God. And God's going to pour out his wrath one day on all those who reject the gospel. I want you to know that. But you know what? I don't have to worry about the wrath of God. You know that? I don't have to sweat about the wrath of God because somebody who loved me took that wrath on themselves and they suffered in my stead. I tell you that. The wrath's gone. Because of Jesus and his love and his grace of God, the wrath is no longer on me, my friend. Yes, they're under the wrath of God. Yes, the question, is there any hope? After Paul having painted a picture of man as he was in his condition, verse 4 said, but God. Boy, you know, when God is in a situation, it'll change things. When God is present, it'll change things.
Right.
When God touches your life, you'll change.
That's right.
You'll change. You won't be the same. But it's about God. But God. There are three great words in these two verses. That without these words, we wouldn't have any hope whatsoever. Three great words. One is love. One is mercy. One is grace. My friend, without those three words, we'd be most miserable. I'm so glad the Bible says God is love. You know that? That's his attribute. That's one of God's attributes, one of his characteristics. He is love. You can't change that. God loves everybody. He loves the righteous. He loves the unrighteous. But before I was saved, he loved me.
Amen.
He loves you. He loves everybody. Whoever you are, wherever you are, God loves you. I want you to know that.
Amen.
And the greatest proof that God loves us is the cross. The cross, the cross, the cross of Jesus.
Amen.
For on that cross, Jesus revealed to all humanity his great love.
That's right.
For you and I. His great love. Paul, writing chapter 3 of Ephesians, he'd been talking to that church there about some great things as us. And Paul, one of those folk that really appreciate the love of God. Paul says this. He said, I'm praying for you that you might know, the love of God. Might know it. Might know how wide it is. How wide it is. Includes everybody, the whole wide world. You might know its height.
Yes, right.
The height. All the way from here to glory. That's what God's love is. His height. His depth. No matter how low you sink, his love is there for you. He's talking about you might know the love of God. Then he says, which passes knowledge.
Yes.
It's so great we can't know it.
That's right.
The Holy Spirit has to work in your life and reveal to you something about his love. But thank God for his love. Thank God he's a God of love. How he loves us. How he loves us. Paul says is that God revealed his love for you and I while we was lost sinners. He didn't wait for us to be saved. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. Yes, he is a God of love. And he says this in verse 4, God who is rich in mercy. For his great love. The reason God is rich in mercy, it stems from his love.
That's right.
The root of mercy is love. And Paul says he's rich in mercy. You know that?
Amen.
Well, God's rich in everything. And he's rich in mercy. And I'm so glad God's rich in mercy. He has to use a lot of it on me, I tell you that. And he'll send a lot for you, I tell you that. He'll never run out of mercy. God is so rich in mercy. Yes, David knew something about the mercy of God. Let me tell you what mercy is, first of all. So what is mercy? Jeremiah said it's because of his great mercy that we're not all consumed. Jeremiah went out of the Babylonians, had burnt Jerusalem, just burnt the city. Bodies strode everywhere. Thousands taken into captivity. And Jeremiah said, Lord, were it not for your great mercy, all of us would have been gone.
That's right.
If it weren't for his mercy, we all be gone today.
That's right.
The mercy of God is when God doesn't give us what we deserve. When God doesn't give us what we deserve. Say, preacher, what do we deserve? We deserve death.
Right.
Bible says the wages of sin is death. That's God's law. So if we got our just what we deserve, we all be dead. But God is a merciful God. David knew something about that. David committed, we know, two awful sins. He plotted to have one of his best friends killed. He took his wife for his own, and she was pregnant. David thought he got by with it. Boy, sometimes we think we do things at night and nobody will know about it. I don't care what you do it. God knows about it. God knows about it. But God sent his servant, Nathan, to confront David about what he did. told him a story about a man with one lamb. And the man took and slew his lamb. The rich man slew his lamb to provide a meal. And David said, that man is worthy of death. David said, you're the man.
That's right.
You're the man. He pronounced sentence on himself.
He did.
You're the man. You're the man. And David said, you know what? I am the man. He was the king. He could have had him executed right then. He said, I'm the man. I'm guilty. Then Nathan said, you will not die. God has put away. You see, how about that? He's put away mine.
Yeah.
But my sins is gone. If you've trusted Jesus as Savior, your sins is no wrong or wrong. But if you haven't, you haven't. Still, with your sins, yes. He knew something about mercy. You remember that old publican and Pharisee went to the temple to pray? Well, at first he was a proud fella. He didn't ask for anything. He told God all the things he did. God wasn't concerned about that. He told God everything he did. He fights twice a day. He do this and he does that. He wasn't. And he seen that old publican over there, a tax collector. He said, that dirty rascal over there. He's been a cheat and a liar all his life. And he had been. And that publican knew where he had been. And he knew he had no right to call on God. But that publican said, God, be merciful. Don't give me what I deserve. Be merciful to me, a sinner. He confessed he was unworthy. He confessed to what it was, and he was asking for mercy. And what did God tell him? That man went home justified. Justified. You know what justified means? God declared him no longer guilty.
That's right.
Yeah. Not guilty. I'm no longer guilty. His mercy. Because God is a love, his mercy. He's a gracious God. Because God is a God of love, he's gracious. Mercy and grace. The Bible says God saves us by his grace, and that's true. Grace is when God gives us what we don't deserve. Well, God gave me something I didn't deserve. He rescued me from the penalty of sin. Sin has a penalty. Wages of sin is death. But God offers a gift. But the gift of God is what? Eternal life. And every person, for those who reject the gift of God, whoever you are will suffer the penalty of death. Everlasting death in the lake that burns with fire and brimstone forever and forever and forever. You either take the gift or you take the wrath. There's two choices. But he says this, but God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us. He says this, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us up together with Christ. By grace are we saved. You know, there's one other attribute of God I want to mention before I leave that. His grace and his mercy and his love. And this also stems from his love. It's his compassion. Our God is a compassionate God. You know that? He's full of compassion. He's full of compassion. You know what word compassion means? To suffer with. You recall when Jesus went to the home of Mary and Lazarus where Lazarus had died?
Yeah.
He said, Jesus wept.
Yeah.
Why did he weep? That family was weeping. He was entering into the suffering, the heartbreak to suffer with. It means when we are brokenhearted, He's brokenhearted. Amen? That's what it means. He has compassion. He has compassion because he loves us. You remember there was a poor leper. Poor leper approached Jesus. He said, Lord, if you're willing, you can make me whole. Now, when he says, if you're willing, he says, it's by your grace. But he says, it's I know if you're willing, you can make me whole. That's faith. Jesus says, I'm willing. Be clean. And he was cleansed. He said, he looked on him and had compassion on him.
That's right.
Had compassion. He said, be clean. Leper was clean. I was a leper one time. In that day, there was no cure for leprosy. No known cure of disease that day. 100,000 died with leprosy and leprosy and leprosy. But there was times when God came on the scene that they were made whole. Only God has a cure for leprosy.
That's it.
Sin is a type of leprosy.
Yeah.
It destroys your life. You can't get rid of it. The physician can't give you nothing for it. But God has a remedy. God has a remedy for sin. You know what the remedy is? It's the gospel of Jesus Christ. Paul says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for the gospel is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who will believe. Amen? That's the remedy, my friend. No one has to die a leper. No one has to die in sin. We recall this story, this beautiful story Jesus told about the Good Samaritan. You remember the story of the Good Samaritan? And this stranger, this wayfarer man had been traveling. And boy, he was attacked by thieves and all this. And lay inside a highway road, bleeding, dying, it says. And two folk come by, who you thought would have gave him a hand. The old priest passed him by. They didn't have time. The Levite passed him by. Boy, if the preacher don't help him, God, who's going to help us? If the preacher don't care, who's going to care? If I don't care, who's going to care?
Amen.
If the deacons don't care, who's going to care? If we don't care, who's going to care? But he says, that good Samaritan was traveling. And he saw the stranger. They're dying, bleeding beside the road. He looked at him, said he had compassion on him. Think about this. You and me will lay inside the road of life, dying and bleeding in sin one day. And guess what happened? The Samaritan came, looked on your misery, and had compassion.
That's right.
And took you up and cured you. Yes. Yes. There's hope. Is there any hope? Talk about those words. Love, grace, and mercy. That's where we find hope. That's the only place to look for hope, is grace and mercy. You know, I'm going to get out of your way in just a minute. You know, when you read Exodus 2, the children of Israel is down in Egypt. They went there because of it, when Joseph was there, because of the drought. And now these 69 souls that went down here is millions of souls now. Millions of souls. And it's been quite a while since Joseph was there. And they've forgotten how faithful Joseph was. And they begin to look around. The king of Egypt, Pharaoh, said, you know, man, these Israelites is more than well. Wouldn't you do something about them people? So they tried all sorts of things. They tried to limit them and all this and all that. And they tried to make slaves out of them. Put them in the brick pits. And they were slaving out there. They're in Egypt. And he said this. God looked down on them. And he remembered something. He remembered his covenant with Abraham. That was passed on to Isaac. That was passed on to Jacob. God remembered. He said he heard their cry. Now, they weren't crying because they were looking to God. They was crying because of the mess they was in. Because of the suffering. They were crying out. And God had compassion. And God says, I'm going to do something. And he called a man named Moses. And he went and delivered his people. How many times have we got in trouble and cried out to God? Because we was in trouble. Lord, if you help me out of this mess, I'll never do it again. How many times did I say that? Just, Lord, just help me out one more time. I've been a fool. Help me out. And he was gracious and merciful and did. You know, if God hadn't sent Moses, those folk would have died in Egypt.
That's right.
They couldn't free themselves. They would have died. Slaves. Egypt is a picture of the world. Represents where we live. You and I were slaves to a great master, Satan. He was our master. Through the flesh and all that, he was our master. And we could never, never have freed ourselves. No matter how we tried, somebody had to come in and set us free. Come in and free us. Thank God. God loved us. And he provided a remedy. He sent forth a man. Sent forth a man 2,000 years ago who died on the cross to pay our sin debt. And when we trust him, he'll pay, he'll deliver us from the power of Satan. Not only from the power of Satan, my friend, he'll give us a new life and a new walk. Yes, Jesus came. He came. He came. He came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. All Paul says this. The old Philippian jailer, you remember him? He was a rascal. He was this. He was that. He was a hardened Roman. But two of God's men were locked up there one night, Paul and Silas. And boy, they had been whipped and did all this and did all that. And they could have been complaining and cussing out the Roman government and all this and all that. But he knew that. They knew that wasn't doing good. But they called on somebody who they knew could help. They knew who called on somebody who would make a difference. And so they began to pray that night and sing praises to the glory of God. You know what? And God heard their prayer and God answered that prayer. And he sent an earthquake and he shut that prison and all the doors flung open. Boy, you know that? That jailer woke up, astonished. All the doors open. He takes his sword out. He said, I'd rather die than face what Rome's going to do to me. And just before he stabbed himself, Paul said, do yourself no harm. For we are all here. He couldn't believe his eyes. He was trembling, carrying the lantern around. And seeing they were. And in that moment, that jailer realized something. Facing death, he realized he wasn't ready to die. I don't care who you are. If you don't know the Lord, when you face death, you'll know you're not ready to die. He said, what must I do to be saved? What do I have to do? Do I have to pay a lot of money? Do I have to run this and do that? What do I have to do? Paul answered that man once and for all in you and I. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. You'll be saved. That's it. Believe on him. That means we believe that he is who he said he was. We believe he is who he said. He's God's son, born of the Virgin Mary. That's who he is. He's the Son of God. We must also believe in what he did on the cross for you. That's the gospel. Paul said, let me tell you what the gospel is. The gospel is that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. He did die. He was buried. He was buried in a tomb. And he rose again alive forevermore on the third day. That's the gospel. And we realize that we were the guilty one. You realize when Jesus died, he died on a borrowed cross. That wasn't his cross. Barabbas was supposed to die. You know the story. I wonder how Barabbas felt when he saw Jesus on his cross. I wonder how he felt. You think he was thankful? Think he was rejoicing? Think he was shouting? I bet he wasn't cussing, I tell you that. How do you feel when he was on your cross? When he was on your cross, he was on my cross. He took my place and died for me so I don't have to die.
That's right.
That's the gospel.
Amen.
He died for me. And he saved me. Paul says, it's by grace. We can't earn it. We can't merit. We can't do nothing. By grace, we've been saved. The only part we have is faith, is our trust. This morning, in that lesson on faith, it's faith. It's to trust God and trust his word. We're saved by faith. He says, then it says this. Trust him. It says, by faith, that it says, that not of yourselves. It is, that is salvation. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Then he says, for we are his workmanship. Creating Christ Jesus, do good works. I don't have time to go through all that. But you know, we said, man's past, man's present. People are being saved today. They being indwelt, working for the Lord, serving the Lord. Let's go to the future. Christ, our glorious future. Boy, what a future it is. What a future. I don't have time to talk about all these things in the future. Think about your future home. The home you're going to have. That home in glory that Jesus is now preparing. John said in Revelation, I saw a sight of the new Jerusalem coming down from heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for a husband. And I'll be that new Jerusalem. It's the place that Jesus is preparing for his church even now. Either way, it's going to be a beautiful place. I'm a proud place, and I'll come again. A beautiful place. We have a brand new body. Won't worry about growing old and all this and all that, arthritis and all the things we suffer from, hospitals, no funerals, no that, none of that. Boy, we're going to have all those things. We're going to be perfect before him. You know, when Pilate was examining Jesus, so you know I find no fault in him. I've examined him, and I can't find nothing to accuse him of. So y'all brought these charges, but I can't find anything in this man. Yet he sentenced him to death. You need to be Jude 24 sometime, one chapter 24. He says, God, Jesus is able to present you and I before the throne of his glory. He's able to keep us from falling without fault, without blemish. When we stand before God, he'll say about us what Pilate said about Jesus. I find no fault in him. Boy, I got a lot of faults. You didn't know that, did you? I'm covered with faults. Boy, I wish I didn't have all I have. But you know, when I stand before there, I won't stand on my own. I'm going to stand there in Christ.
That's right.
In Christ. In Christ, we're perfect. We're perfect. A perfect individual with a brand new body, with a glorified body, without blemish. And notice what Paul says this about after being saved in 19. He says, therefore, you're no more strangers and foreigners to the covenants in this, but you're fellow members of the household of God. I'm in God's family. God has adopted me into his family. I'm a child of God. I have a heavenly Father who hears me when I speak. So many wonderful things. Our past, we without hope. Jesus came on the scene to give us hope. And we have a wonderful future. When Paul was at, has pianos and choir come on. When Pilate was examining Jesus, And those folk were demanding the death of Jesus. And they were saying this. He said he found no fault. He asked this pertinent question. Then what shall I do with you, who is the Christ? He asked that question. What am I going to do with Jesus, who's the Christ? That crowd said, let him be crucified. Get rid of him. And that question that Paul asked, we must ask ourselves the same question. We can't escape it. What are you going to do with Jesus? Are you going to be like Pilate? Crucify him! Crucify him! He means nothing to me. What's going to be your decision? You can't escape it. You must make it. As the choir is singing, if God has spoken in your heart, we said this moment earlier, you either have the gift of God or the wrath of God. It's one or the other. You can take his wrath or his gift. Boy, yeah, I'm so glad he persuaded me to take his gift. Don't worry about the wrath. The wrath is past. The singers can come on. I'll be quiet. As they sang, this invitation hymn, if God has spoken to you, the door is open. The devil's fooled you long enough. It's time to get up. Listen to these voices, these words.
I am without one plea. For
the Lord is speaking through this song.
And thy love was shed for me. And thou bidst me come to
is able. Whatever your need is, if you're lost, he's willing to save. He's not willing that anyone perish. And so God has touched some lives already. God has already given some folk a warning. It is now time to get things right. Oh gosh, I wish I could save everybody. I would. Maybe you're out of fellowship. You said, Preacher Crafton, I've lost my joy. I've lost the joy I used to have. I don't have that enthusiasm I used to have. Something's happened. in my life. And I want to get it straightened out. I'm so glad the Bible has the answer. It says, if we are saved, if we confess our sins. If we confess, he's faithful and just to forgive us and to restore us to that place we live. That place. Invitation's open. Will there be one? Say, just remember me in prayer. Brother Hilton, just remember me in prayer. I have some problems. I want you to remember me. I'm not where I need to be. But I'm lost. But I don't want to die lost. I need some prayer. Will there be one just to come and say, preacher, I'm in need. And I believe God can meet that need. Will there be one? I've given you all I have. I don't have anything else. I'll give you what God gave me. May God ever bless you. Brother Hilton.
Amen. Brother Crafton has really challenged us. He's shared with us the grace, the mercy, and the love of God. And God's given us what we don't deserve. By his grace, we have received the gift of God. We can, if you don't know him as Lord and Savior, he's being gracious right now and offering you what you don't deserve. He's being gracious right now, merciful right now, in that we haven't received what we do deserve. I don't know where you were at. I know where I was at, on my way to hell. And if you're here today and you are born again, there was a time in your life, whether you realize it or not, you were on your way to hell. And if you're here today and you don't know Jesus as Lord and Savior, you are on your way to a demon's hell. That's where you're headed. But you don't have to, because of his mercy. Because of his mercy. Because of his grace. Because of his love. He loves you more than you could ever love yourself. He sees what we can't see. He knows what we don't know. The gravity of salvation, he understands it. He understands it because he died. He was buried. But while he was buried, he conquered death, hell, and the grave. And he rose for our victory. He knows what we don't know. We don't know what comes with the sting of death. He does. And he wants to remove the sting of death from us. I'm glad he removed it from me. There's a lot of things I worry about in this life. I don't worry about dying. I don't worry about dying because he paid my penalty. And I'm willing to receive his payment. What he's done for me, I'm willing to receive that grace. Why would you pay for something that's already been paid for? If you knew when you opened the door of your home that your mortgage was paid in full, I don't believe you would give a dime to the bank. You wouldn't repay a mortgage. You wouldn't repay a vehicle payment. Matter of fact, you'll go fuss with them because you'll keep track of how many payments you've made for that vehicle. But Jesus paid for death. He paid the death so you wouldn't have to. Thank you, Brother Crafton, for pouring out what God has poured into you. We thank you for being here. We're going to ask everyone, if you would, to stand. Know that we're praying for you, those of you who are lost. We're praying that God would move and minister in your heart this week. And if he does, all you've got to do is say, I'm willing to serve you. Call someone and tell them that you're serving Jesus, that you believe the gospel, you've received the gospel, and you're going to live out the gospel. If you're willing to do that, I believe you're saved. But you've got to be willing to do it. Again, we do.